that kid in the white shirt doing?
That's your mom.
Nice and quiet, neighbors. Thank you. Yeah, let's get move the kid away from the door, please. Here we go. We got it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Here we go. And roll it.
Let me drive you home.
Get out of my face, faggot!
I'm erasing you, and I'm happy.
Michelle likes a certain amount of spontaneity and chaos, and kind of our job was to scurry around and to try to make those ideas come true when they were appropriate. And trying to manage that is a challenge with Michelle.
Yeah, as an example of that, the scene that you see in the movie
when he's running up and down the street.
The perfect ending to this piece of shit story!
And slowly his signs that are in the store are being erased, and he's eventually morphed from one take into another take. We really couldn't keep track of what was going on, and said to him at that point, said, look, if it's working for you, then it's working for us, because we don't get what's going on.
I'm Anthony Bregman.
Steve Golan.
We were the producers of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Okay, that's the scene when you see Clementine leaving Joel. That's the last time he saw her together. It's a big climax in terms of emotion. She leaves him, they have this big argument, and he feels sorry, and he runs after her. And at the same time, he's starting to realize that his memory keep shifting and keep dissolving, and the time seems repeated in loop. I mean, I had a good time doing that. You know the feeling of déjà vu? That would be an explanation of that. That it's another time, it's another situation, but there is something in common in it that makes it feel you lived it already.
My name is Michel Gondry. I am French, and I directed Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
Essentially, that scene was one that was pretty much constructed in Michel's head, because I don't think any of us totally understood what he was doing at
Not
the time.
At all.
He was saying, okay, now run there. Okay, now look up, now run back, now slow down. And no one knew, and the camera was just
panning
back and forth.
He in the script, he was saying, anyway, I'm erasing you, I'm happy. Look, everything is falling apart here. And I chose this parking lot when everything seems to be broken on the side, but it was kind of too subtle for him to say, look around, everything is falling apart here. We needed something more.
I mean, the car falling out of the sky, I never knew that was gonna happen until post.
Well, yeah, and actually the way that came about was, as Clementine was running down the street, Jim says, you know, look at it, it's all falling apart. And it doesn't really fall apart until
later
on when he's running back and forth. Initially, we said, well, wait a minute, it's not really falling apart, so we have to do something. So,
right.
we decided, okay, why don't we cut off one of her legs in CG? And so we cut off a leg, and so she's walking with one leg there. And when we looked at it, we were laughing, and we had the funniest moment in the film. And then we showed it to a test audience, and there wasn't like a peep.
They didn't even notice it, I don't think.
So we said, okay, well, why don't we, because maybe it's because it's too dark and the shot is too short. So we actually extended the shot so that her walking with one leg goes for twice as long by morphing two different takes of it. And then we looked at it again, rolled on the floor in laughter, and then we brought it to another test screening, not a peep.
Yeah.
And so we said, okay, we have to do something a little more apparent.
Well, these days, creating CGI cars is pretty easy, if I can say it that way. I mean, there's a lot of car commercials that's been done, and they're all CG. So we felt very comfortable that we could achieve a photoreal car falling from the sky. Hi, I'm Louis Morin. I work for Buzz. I do visual effects for feature films, and it's an honor for me to have had to do this work for him.
Look at it out here! It's all falling apart!
In order to do that, because there was no blue screen, nothing, so we had to roto Kate Winslet completely and redo the whole environment in CGI with a CGI fence, CGI sidewalk, CGI cars, and we also had debris and particles to make it look real. And since it's a night shot, I think it's much easier to make it believable.
First, it was not really accepted. But then we realized that it was really one of the scariest moments of the film, and it was really important that we set up, okay, this place is dangerous. It's not a place you want to be, it's a place you want to escape.
I'm not sure if people laughed, but people certainly jumped.
Yeah, well, it's so loud.
The sound was so loud, yeah.
You did it to me first! cliff! Can you hear me? By morning, you'll be gone!
I would say my favorite moment on all the orchestra sessions I've done so far in my life is giving people parameters to be creative within. Hi, I'm John Bryan. We're here at Westwood Music in Westwood, LA, and I composed the score for Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind.
It's amazing how you can take an orchestra, you have a partition like that, with the bars, and if you do that, or that, you can actually give that to the musician and they could play them.
If I just say, okay, I want the entire violin section to play this note, and then maybe something as simple as pointing to a woodwind section or a brass section saying, I'm not going to tell any of you what note to play, but whenever I raise my left hand, you should start playing louder until my hand goes down. And the next time I bring it up, everybody pick new notes. All of a sudden, you have an instant piece of unique music.
By morning, you'll be gone! The perfect ending to this piece of shit story!
Michel operates with the world of opportunities in front of him every moment. So he, if we were to discard something, will come up with some fantastic thing, you know? What is the sound of, you know, a school of fish swimming and making a right turn, you know? What represents that? Why don't we have that be this whole section? I find that wonderful. I think some people can find that frustrating. I think for people who try to produce movies, that kind of thought is just like, oh no, he just added 18 crane shots. I personally love it. We talked about what are different things we could have them do that just wouldn't ever happen. And Michel just reached into his pocket where he had Tic Tacs, and this before we went to Seattle, and she goes like, oh, like this? And I'm like, great. So we knew we were going to do that before we got there. And he made sure to have a box of Tic Tacs. I mean, that's a fun moment just to watch the faces of these people who only ever work in one way, getting a Tic Tac, like, what do you mean there's a shaker here? And a few of them are just sort of like, what is this bullshit? This is not the Rite of Spring. This is not why I went to music school. There's some French guy and some fucking rock guy in a hat, and they're making me put Tic Tacs in it. This bow costs more than their car.
When you have like 60 musicians on all acoustic, playing in one direction, even if it's all different notes and there is no sense of harmony, it's always harmonious, and it's such a powerful tool. And for the scary moments, we wanted to create those abstract sounds.
Is there something wrong with a girl being attracted to me? Is that a problem?
Michel knew exactly what he wanted to do with that scene of having Jim run back and forth and be at the other end. Although it was hard to visualize how he would do that. And he tried to explain it to us, and when he first explained it to us, we were like, huh? You know, what do you mean? I'm Ellen Karras, and I'm the director of photography of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. That was a location in Yonkers, and his idea was that we would move the camera from one part of the street to the other, and every time we would pass by, something else would disintegrate. Now, normally people would do something like that with motion control, where you do motion control and things would change, you would change it and it would be exactly the same. But Michel was definitely not into doing that. That's not what this movie was about. In fact, he wanted it to be as rough as it could be. And there were times when he told me to shake the camera, to move it much more, so that we could see that it wasn't a motion control shot.
When I saw the shot list, I kind of laughed, because the first conversation I had with him, I said, Michel, you don't like blue screen, do you? And he answered, oh, I've done many blue screen, it always shows, so I don't use blue screen anymore. And then I said, what about motion control? say, oh, I did a lot of motion control, and it always looked like mechanical. So he went handheld camera on this film, and we had to deal with this.
To me, it's coming from this dream when I'm trying to escape people, and I'm running, and I watch a street that pass by, and then I keep running on the same street, And I think it's a good representation of how you feel when you are in those nightmares. And you feel you are in a place you can't escape. Because the danger to do movies that happen only in your head is people think, well, it's only a dream, it's only a memory, that's nothing dangerous gonna happen. But if you really get the sense it's physical, and if you push a door, you end up in the same room, and you walk across a street, and it's the same street again, then you feel you're in a dream, but you feel something really nasty that you have in nightmare that I wanted to have for this movie.
Basically, Michel decided to go NL camera and had this vision of this mirror effect that he wanted to do. So basically, Jim steps out of his car and goes across into his mirror image where the car is at the end of the street.
So what I did is I leave the car and run this way.
You hear me? By morning, you'll be gone!
And after, I ask him to run back to his car. And what we do is, we flip the shot, and instead to run where Kate is.
A perfect ending to this piece of shit story!
He's actually running back exactly where he was. The trick, in fact, is that people look the same if they are one side or the other side.
So there's four shots, and we had to create seamless transitions from one shot to the other and matching a human body. We used a couple of tricks to create the transitions, like a lamppost. We used some morph as well, and 3D tracking.
And you have to pull your hair, you know, to find the way you're gonna do it. But at the end of the day, it was a really pleasing experience.
The street we used was really, nothing is changing except that the sign in the background are getting more and more blurry here.
But he did a lot of that live action in terms of having the art department change the facade of the building for each pass that we would do.
You'll notice that the Saratoga sign is slightly disappearing. After we do this, we're going to do it again, and it's going to be degraded more. So the memory is even less remembered than it was before. So thanks a lot, guys. Bye-bye.
Michel always liked us to get those kinds of effects as far physically as we possibly could. So in some cases, those signs were painted backwards so that the film could be flipped. So that combination of that one night of shooting was the culmination of a lot of struggle and research and thinking about how this was going to function. I'm Dan Lee. I am the production designer. And we are in my garden in New York City, in Greenwich Village. The main thing with Michel is to listen very, very carefully to him and try your best to accomplish the specific things that he's asking for and the times that it works, which is most of the time. You know, he is very kind and appreciative.
Action!
You didn't give me a signal.
The times that something doesn't work, then there's like the level of frustration that happens on any set. But he has a wonderful way of just saying, no, I know this is going to work. I know we can make this work. We just have to make some adjustments, and this is going to work. And you have to have the faith with Michel that, okay, we're going to try it again. We're going to make the adjustments. And it works.
It was actually the shoot in which Jim Carrey mania most heavily manifested itself in the film, because hundreds and hundreds of kids showed up, and kind of we had to make barricades for it. And every time Jim did a take, there'd be this roar of applause at the end and screaming and, yeah, good going. And, you know, they would like laugh actually in the middle of each take. So we have to, in addition to make visual effects, we have to do sound effects to cut out, you know, the sound of an audience.
So nice knowing I'm not as famous as he is. See what I mean? He gets a coat, I don't even get a coat.
Aww, wow.
That sequence epitomizes the spirit of Eternal Sunshine. It was all about, you know, a large group of people coming together to make a largely unusual movie, you know? And so there were a lot of things which are not, you know, according to what one would expect, the book of filmmaking, you know? But so much better for it.
You do have to give yourself over. And when I did that, that is the time that the combination of myself and Michelle and Ellen and those things would come together, and that is why the sequence is as successful as it is.
Hi guys, how you doing?
Thank you.